Hello, and welcome to Nerds and Stuff. My name is Martin, and today we're going to be making characters for our new campaign in the role-playing system, Urban Shadows. Before we get to building our characters, I'm going to have my players introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Sterling.
I'm Daniel.
I'm Junior.
Perfect. Okay. So, like I said, my name is Martin. I will be the Master of Ceremonies, or the Game Master, for this upcoming campaign of Urban Shadows. My players have all read through the book, picked archetypes or classes that they will be playing, and so we're going to go ahead and just kind of start getting into it. We won't be talking about mechanics too much in this. We'll be going over the mechanics when we actually begin playing the game, and starting out very slow and steady and building on what we set as a foundation for the rules and for our campaign as we play. If you're interested in jumping straight to the campaign, we'll put a pop-up card here in the top right of your screen, and you can click on that to enter directly to the campaign. We also previously shot a city building hour-long video, which I will have down in the description below, and you can click on that to see how we got to some of the locations and some of the designs of our city that we'll be playing in, which is known as New Salem. So with that in mind, we're going to go ahead and just jump right into character creation. Now, in this game is powered by the Apocalypse. For anyone who's played one of those AWE or Powered by the Apocalypse games, such as Dungeon World, Apocalypse World, or Masks, or anything like that. There's 10 archetypes in the game, and they have all picked an archetype that they will begin playing this campaign as. Sterling, would you like to kind of introduce basically your archetype and just like a quick one sentence idea of what your archetype is, and we'll go around?
So I'm going to be playing a wizard. The wizards are very much powerful magic spellcasters.
I mean, wizards pretty self-explanatory.
Yeah,
they're wizards.
I think all of these but juniors might be pretty self-explanatory, right? Daniel.
I'm playing the vamp. My primary job is to kind of weave a huge web of debt and pressure everyone to do what I want.
And Junior.
I'm playing Tainted, so it's basically a half-human, half-demon, that's basically on Earth to serve his patron.
Yep, his demon master. So those will be our archetypes, and this game has character sheets that are each unique in their own way, and so we're going to be kind of going through those and building on the fiction as we go. So the first thing in playing this game as a player is choosing an archetype. Now, some of the stuff that you do even before an archetype or before we come to the table is we fill in the lore blanks. This book has a lot of content in it, but it doesn't define everything for you. It doesn't tell Daniel what his vampire is. It doesn't tell Sterling what his magic is. It doesn't tell Junior here what the demonic world looks like or how the demons interact with the tainted. So that's a lot of stuff that we fill in before we come to this table, and as we play at this table, we'll be filling in those blanks as well. Next, on each and everybody's character sheets, there is a name, a look, and a demeanor. So I'm going to have everybody kind of go through here, and everybody's picked names prior to this, but we are going to be picking our looks and demeanors. So go ahead and circle whichever ones fit best for your character archetype. Now, while they're doing these, there's going to be a lot of them looking down at their character sheets, circling stuff, reading things, writing things. We'll cut out most of that and just jump to the actual good stuff. Sometimes I'll be describing aspects of this game. So the first thing, I'm going to let these guys actually go through their stuff, but I'll kind of jump back and forth while they're writing and try and keep the dialogue going while they're deciding how to build their character. We'll generally do a massive introduction later in the character building process, but we'll talk through some of these early decisions as we go. So first thing we're going to do is I'm going to have everybody just introduce their name, how they look, and basically their demeanor, right? Their the look of them. This is the look is kind of what the camera sees, and the demeanor is kind of it is obviously your demeanor, but it's how you carry yourself. How the other players know you. It's not quite a reputation yet, but it's your swagger, right? So let's go ahead and start with Sterling. Sterling, let's hear your name.
Name is Calvin Miles. He is a Caucasian male. He wears nicer clothing, but it is very much like, worn sloppily. His tie is undone. His shirt might only be halfway tucked in, something like that.
Once in a while, there's a stain.
Yeah. And his demeanor is disheveled. Okay. He is just a wreck of a man.
Perfect, yeah. It is always day. It is always laundry day in Calvin's world. Perfect. He is a daily and a dollar shirt, isn't he?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Perfect. Daniel.
I will be playing the vampire Oliver Silver. He's a Caucasian male who has... he primarily wears formal clothing. A lot of nice suits and kind of nice attire. And he has a very seductive demeanor.
Perfect. As vampires should. Junior, let's hear a little bit about your character.
So I'll be playing Jake Gordon. He's a male Caucasian. Wears dirty clothes because he's poor, doesn't really have much of anything. Because he's a docks worker. So, and his demeanor is volatile. So wild card, just kind of.
Absolutely.
It's like my foil.
Yeah. You guys are starting your buddy cop show soon, I believe. Yeah. Perfect. All right. So after we've already picked our archetype, and now we're moving down the list, we did our name, look, and demeanor. The next thing we'll be doing is our stats. Like most role-playing games, there are base characteristics or base stats. Think of Dungeons & Dragons. This is your strength, your dexterity, your constitution. If you're a big fan of the Star Wars FFG, like the Legacy of Ash campaign, that's like your brawn, your coordination, your cunning. In this game, there are only four stats for your primary characteristics, right? We have blood, which is the measure of your character's fight or flight. It is how tough, dangerous, coiled, or quick to act you are. That is blood. Next is your heart. Is the sum of your passion, charm, charisma, getting what you want, relates to your heart. Next is mind, a reflection of your critical thinking, trickery, and observation skills. It's your cunning and deceit. Once again, that was mind. And lastly is spirit, your connection to the other, and your force of will, your focus and determination under pressure. So blood, heart, mind, and spirit. Each one of these archetypes starts out with four basic numbers. And on character creation, you can add one to one of your choice. So go ahead and do that now and fill in the middle of your character sheet. So with this game, there's only four characteristics, and it's a fairly rules-light system. So there's a lot of room for flexibility, interpretation, and keeping the narrative going. And like our other campaigns or other role-playing games on this channel, a lot of this game is going to be about putting fun first, right? There is room in these rules for ambiguity, discussion, deliberation, but first and foremost, the rule at this table is to have fun first, mm-hmm. and these four characteristics are vague enough to where we can interpret that. Is it blood? Is it mind? Is it spirit? Or is it heart? And go from there. Next, we will be looking at our faction stats. As I mentioned, in the city building video, there are four factions of supernatural or... supernatural related peoples at work in this city of New Salem. There is the mortality faction. These are normal humans and most of the people in our setting. Now, the mortality faction has three subsets of playable archetypes. One is the aware, someone who has recently become aware of the supernatural world. There is the hunter, someone who is actively hunting, quite literally with weapons, supernatural characters for reasons of their own purpose. And lastly is the veteran, someone who has been in this city, who has paid their dues, who has seen everything under the sun in this city, supernatural or otherwise. And so there is the mortality, there is the night faction. Now, the night faction are creatures of darkness. Once human, they are vampires, wolves, and ghosts. So once again, three subsections. Obviously, vampires are vampires. Wolves are the werewolves of the night. And lastly, ghosts or specters. These are the people who have deceased but are still tethered to this world for some reason to basically get that... last thing done.
Whatever, so they need for closure.
Yep, so they can move on or haunt the person who put them into the next realm. Next is power. Humans with supernatural power, blessings and curses. These are wizards and oracles who are playable archetypes and also immortals. There are immortals in the setting. They are not playable archetypes. They might be in expanded books or something like that. But wizards, oracles, and immortals are people of power in the faction and in the city. And lastly, wild. Otherworldly beings that originate from outside of our world. Fairies, demons, and the bizarre. In the book, it actually talks about a trash monster that is made up of refuse books. I think it shoots a book at one of the players in the example. So,
the bizarre. Good thing I don't live in the poor neighborhoods.
The book also talks about trolls and all sorts of other creatures. So, wild is very much not of this world. So, those are the factions: mortality, night, power, and wild. Each one interacting as a community, as a atmosphere within this city of New Salem. Each archetype starts with different standings in each faction. Obviously, the Tainted has a higher running with Wild than they might with other factions because they are of the Wild faction. They are of the demonic world. Same thing with Daniel's Vampire. They are very respected in the Night faction, but might not be in other factions. So go ahead and write down your new stats, and as with before, with your base stats, you get to add +1 to one faction of your choice that you would like to know contacts in, have more influence in, stuff like that. Perfect. All right. So before we get into our intro questions, we're going to go through our stats and basically briefly touch on your four stats. Which one you boosted and briefly why. We don't need to know. Obviously, if you boosted blood, you probably want to be badass. If you boosted mind, you probably want to be more intelligent, you know. So we'll just go through for our archetypes super quick and just say, rattle them off. And we'll start with Sterling.
Okay. So for my stats, I started with blood -1, heart 0, mind 1, and spirit 2. I did boost spirit. It gives for the easier access to the magical powers. He's been doing this for quite a long time.
Okay. So spirit was 1 and you boosted it to 2. Okay. To have a stronger connection with the magical world.
Yes.
Perfect. And Daniel?
I set my blood at 2, my heart at 1, my mind at 0, and my spirit at -1.
Okay.
I did that because primarily most of my vampire abilities roll with blood.
Okay, and so you boosted blood.
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, Junior.
I also did the same. I raised up my blood to 2, my heart to 1, my mind to -1, and spirit 0.
Perfect. So in this game, no stat ever goes below -3 or above +3. These are very small wiggle room of stats. This isn't like Dungeons and Dragons where you can have a strength of 18. In this game, blood of 3 means, you're really hardy. You're really good at these kind of combat maneuvers or, these decisions that go on. Mm-hmm. And then we'll go through faction stats real quick and which one you boosted as well. Sterling.
Okay. I wanted to stay fairly neutral, so I ended up boosting my 0 to a 1.
Okay.
So I ended up with mortality 1, knight -1, power 1, wild 1. And wild was the one that I boosted.
Okay, and so your knight is -1, so you're completely oblivious when it comes to vampires, werewolves, and specters. Mm. Yeah. But across the board elsewhere, you have a fairly strong reputation with and understanding of. Okay. And the faction stats represent your understanding of the community, your contacts or connections within the community. And so when we do stuff that involves knowing who vampires are, Sterling might be at a disadvantage where that's where Daniel comes in with his factions.
Right, and I set my factions to mortality to 1. I boosted my knight to 2.
Okay.
Powers are -1 and wild is 0.
Okay.
I figure I interact a lot with some of the creatures of darkness, and so I would probably know them a little bit better than I would those crazy people that deal with magic.
Absolutely. Those who seek power, mortal or otherwise. Okay.
So for me, I actually increased mortality just because, as you learn in my backstory, you'll know more. Then I have a -1 knight, a 0 power, and a wild 1.
Perfect. Okay, so we're moving on to intro questions. Each one of these has, I believe, 4 or 5 intro questions that are your basic. We'll touch on these super briefly. I don't want to go into too much detail. Obviously, a lot of this will be revealed as we play in our campaign, but these create a very strong background baseline or foundation for our characters. So go ahead and take your time, as much as needed, to fill out your intro questions. Okay, while they're doing that, we're going to talk a little bit about this game. These characters do not come prepared with a backstory. They have picked their archetype, and they have an idea of who they want to play. We'll find out in a few moments about Sterling's professor, right? He's a professor at a university, and we'll talk more about what that means. So he's come to the table knowing that he wants to be a wizard. He has an idea that he wants to be a professor at a university, stuff like that. They don't write a full-page backstory. We don't get that from them. Additionally, as a GM, I don't come prepared with a plot. I don't prepare the story in advance. We all play this game to find out what happens. Powered by the Apocalypse games are very much fluid in nature. If the second you start planning your next move, you're alienating what the city demands, what the fiction demands, what the dice tell us is going to happen. This game is very much a open conversation. I was recently talking with one of my players on this channel. His name is Daniel Sheldon, and we were discussing that this game doesn't have initiative. In this game, GMs don't roll dice. I never will roll dice in this game. That's probably a benefit to my players because I roll dice pretty well.
He's pretty cool.
Especially if you guys watch the Star Wars campaign, there's quite a few times when I drop a player with relative ease just because I'm pretty good at rolling those triumphs and those successes. So I don't roll dice. My job is to listen to my players, react to their moves. When they miss a move, I make my moves. And so when their fiction allows me, I create fiction, and we see what happens together as we play this game. Okay, so now that we've gone through our character intro questions, we're going to go through them quickly. I'm going to press on you guys. I'm going to ask follow-up questions. The book talks about taking vague words and pressing on them until we get definite answers. So we're going to start with Sterling. You guys are more than welcome to ask follow-up questions. There is a difference for all of us between helping Sterling find out who his character is and drilling him on questions about his third grade math homework. You know, like, yeah. We don't need to get into that, but we're interested to find out who you are and as much as you are.
All right. So you want me to just read, like, question, answer it?
Yep.
Leave you guys questions?
Yep.
Okay. So the first question, who are you? Calvin Miles is a college professor. He teaches probably like ancient history, and he is tenured. It is more in recent years that his life has really gone bad.
So what caused his life to kind of spiral out of control?
Most recently, this time.
Asterisk.
It was the death of his son.
Oh, wow. Okay.
He had a little girl already, and him and his wife like had another child, a couple years old, and the child ended up passing away. Then just downhill spiral from there.
Of course,
divorce followed, lost custody, things like that.
Of the daughter?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you had a daughter, and then years later you had another son, or
mm-hmm.
you had a son, and the son died.
Yeah.
Pretty young. Okay. How is your relationship with your ex-wife?
It's not like the best. They're cordial,
okay.
But they're not close at all.
You
they
interact,
care about
you
each
interact
other,
because
but they,
of your daughter.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
They care about each other, but they're not going to go out of their way for each other,
okay.
Probably.
And how often do you see your daughter?
Maybe like once a week.
Okay.
He tries to set aside some time to meet with her, talk with her.
Yep.
See how she's going.
And I guess last follow-up question for me, and we'll probably move on, because this is only your first question.
Yes.
What does your daughter think of you? Does she love you, or does she listen to her mom? And, you know, is it very much like when you guys visit each other, is it awkward silence and TV dinners, or is it like you guys have a blast and you hate seeing her go?
It's more on the awkward silence part.
I mean, she's
there's
already
like
a teenage girl,
yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, there's definitely, like, an underlying, like, caring, at least, from Calvin's side, but she, I guess, probably doesn't care that much. She doesn't. She was still fairly young when the son passed away, so it's, she almost views it as Calvin abandoned the family after a hard trial.
Okay.
So does she resent you?
I don't know if resent or more embarrassed by.
Okay, because you are a bit of a mess lately.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Cool. Next question.
How long have you been in the city? 25 or more years, probably.
Okay. So how much of that has been teaching?
At least like a good 20 years of it has been.
Okay. Yeah. So you've been teaching. You're kind of a who's who at the university.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Perfect.
People know about me.
Yeah. For better or for worse.
Yes.
Okay. Next.
What keeps you up at night? He's very paranoid of his past. He's from England, and that's where he first started studying wizardry, and he was very involved with kind of the other wizards and becoming as powerful as he could. But a tragedy kind of happened, and it scared him, and he lost a lot of people he knew, so he fled over to the United States.
Magic and, became unstable, as it tends to do?
Yes, okay. And ended up settling eventually in New Salem.
Okay, and that was a while ago, so it's been a lot. Does he ever go back to England, or not really?
No.
Okay.
I think he's too afraid of like his past catching up with him if
Perfect.
He does.
Yeah. All right, next question.
What have you sacrificed for your power? He has sacrificed his family and sanity. One thing I kind of forgot to mention was he blames himself for his son's death because he was like magic free for a long time, and then he started kind of dabbling again.
And like he has a coin.
He started dabbling again, and that was when stuff kind of went bad. So he kind of thinks that his son's death is a result of him playing with the dark arts.
Okay, sounds good. And is there one more question or not?
Yeah, what do you desperately need? And I think it's almost a self-control, a forgiveness of himself is what he's searching for.
I'm sure for Calvin, what he needs most in his life is just order right now.
Yeah, because
it's so
stability.
Chaotic. Yeah, just, hell, even like a calendar would help, you know, like a daily planner.
What day of the week
a to-do list.
We
yeah.
tried to get him a planner once and it just disappeared.
He showed up to class one day and no one was there. He got really mad and realized it was a Wednesday.
Yeah. Oh man. Classic ancient history professor. Yeah.
Which means he missed the class on Tuesday.
Perfect. All right. Daniel, let's hear a little bit about Oliver Silver.
Okay, well, my first question is, who are you? Oliver is old. He's got quite a bit of history to him.
Okay.
He's a World War II vet. He's also more recently a web developer, and that kind of led to him being a millionaire,
okay.
Which is why he's kind of in the position he is now in New Salem.
So I'm going to press on the two things that kind of caught my eye. One is he's a World War vet, right?
Yes.
Which side did he fight on?
He fought for the Americans.
Okay, for the Allies. And why did he join up? Like, was he infantry?
Yeah, he was just general infantry. When he was born in the 30s and it was early 20s when the war broke out, kind of signed up in the first wave under, you know, that great wave of patriotism.
Mm-hmm.
And
turned the tide, yeah.
You know, he was at Normandy in the landing force.
Okay.
And saw some terrible things until he was eventually wounded. And then, while in a field hospital trying to recover from that wound, he was actually bit there.
Okay.
In the hospital.
By a vampire?
By a goddamn kraut vampire.
So, okay, so was he... So, was the war pretty far along? Were they in France? Were they in Germany?
He was... We'll say it was about 8 months after D-Day.
Okay.
He'd been able to survive that long. And they were still in France, though.
Okay.
That's where they'd moved him back to the field hospital while he was trying to recover. They hadn't sent him out to England.
Gotcha. Perfect. And then the web developer... He's probably tech-savvy.
Right, yeah. Since he was kind of bitten at a young age, he's always perpetually stuck in his early 20s. That's just what he looks like.
Yep.
So when computers kind of came along and started getting popular, he decided this is what the kids are doing. So if he wants to maintain this image and not raise suspicions, he better get into it too. Turns out he was pretty good at it and ended up making a dating website for supernatural beings.
Okay.
Called Bump in the Night. And when smartphones came along, he moved that online dating website into a phone app.
I kind of like, too, that maybe Bump in the Night has, like, a preferences kind of thing.
Yeah.
So, like, mostly it's, like, for the normals, so it can be there as, like, for goths and kind of, like...
Edgy kids.
Yeah, edgy kids. Kids that didn't get enough hugs from their mom. And then there's like a certain code that you just access or something, and then it unlocks the real purpose of the mm-hmm. website and the app. Yeah.
Well, and if you really want, I mean, mortals can meet with
more
supernatural beings.
Edgy people. Super edgy people
that drink
their blood. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we've seen great success.
Perfect.
Made some happy couples. You know, I was kind of lonely for a little while.
Yeah. You guys now have commercials that rival match.com. Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah, we can only air them late at night, though, because that's when our target audience is up.
Of course. Of course.
Yeah.
Okay, next question.
How long have you been in the city? I have been a resident in New Salem for 24 years now.
Okay.
After kind of things took off and the .com stuff got really big,
okay,
I needed to be in a cultural hub.
So we have a gap in between the war and now. Briefly describe what that was.
A good chunk of that was alternating between trying to figure out what I was and how to cope with it and how to exist.
And most of that information is like broke off countries from Russia.
And, trying to hunt down
Eastern European countries.
This German Nazi vampire who bit me and raided essentially what was a field hospital of my friends and killed most of them. And I'm still trying to find that vampire.
Okay.
It was unsuccessful.
Deal. Has he, as far as you know, is he in New Salem?
That was the last lead I had.
Okay, perfect.
That was kind of another reason that brought me here.
Okay.
Is that this is
or maybe he frequents here or something. Yeah.
This is
as vampires tend to do. Yeah. Perfect. Next question.
And he hasn't popped up on the dating site yet.
He has his own one. It's like Grindr or something. Yeah. German seeking Americans. Yeah.
So how do you keep your cravings in check? In my apartment and in my kind of my haven, I keep a healthy supply of chilled blood.
Okay.
Kind of in nice bottle form. To the average person, it would be mistaken as dark wine.
Okay. So I guess my follow-up question for that is, that's how you stay satiated, right?
Yeah, just kind of sipping.
When you don't have that access to you, what do you do to prevent yourself from becoming that feral monster that you love and hate?
I try my best to just find willing persons to kind of experience the feeding process with.
Okay.
And
it's very sensual, you know.
It is. It's an incredibly intimate moment.
Like candles.
And can feel incredible. It's...
I believe the book puts it as better than sex.
Yeah, better than the best sex you've ever had.
I believe that was the exact quote of it, yes.
And so it's easy to be able to find some willing people who've had experience with it before. Because, I mean, not everybody who gets fed on dies.
Yeah.
That's wholly up to the vampire, whether they suck them dry or just take a reasonable meal.
Yeah. And there's like a tab on your app for favorites.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Being the developer, you know, I can sort these things really easily.
Of course.
Into mortals looking for vamps.
Okay. And next question.
Who turned you? And this is Reynald, the Nazi vampire.
Okay.
Whom I am hunting.
Deal. And I think we talked about him previously. Okay,
mm-hmm.
Next question.
What scheme are you invested in now?
As vampires tend to do.
Yes, right now I am trying to find a good way to acquire the Vibe nightclub.
Okay, and the Vibe nightclub is a location that we talked about in our city building video. As I said before, there will be a link to it in the description below. So if you want to see some of these locations, we didn't talk about the university quite yet, but that'll definitely be something relevant as well as Vibe. Perfect. Any questions for Daniel before we move on?
I think he covered it really well.
I think that's my job. I think Masters of Ceremonies is my job to just ask a bunch of questions.
Yeah.
So, Junior, let's hear a little bit about Jake Gordon.
All right, so he's a rough around the edges kind of guy, just normal looking. He's a dock worker, so he's pretty poor.
Salt of the earth.
Yeah, doesn't really have much.
I kind of like the idea that maybe he's like everybody's friend, but nobody's best friend.
Yeah, of course. And so he's about 30. He's 38 is what he is.
Okay.
So.
Deal. What's your next question?
My next question is, how long have you been in the city? I moved to the city 8 years ago. Okay. Just had rough times in other places, and I have some family here, so I decided to come.
Who is your family here?
I have an aunt, Susan, so she works at a diner, and she's kind of the only family I got.
Another salt of the earth.
Another salt of the earth.
Perfect.
So
okay.
Have you got any others, or is it just your aunt left?
Just my aunt.
Okay.
And that's for family?
That's for family, yeah. Next question, who would you die for?
I guess maybe a trail of exes in your wake.
Yeah. So, next question, who would I die for? My girlfriend's daughter, Anna, she's a little five-year-old.
Not your girlfriend.
No, my girlfriend's daughter. So,
So who would you die for? It's your girlfriend's daughter, Anna. Yeah. So first, tell me a little bit, tell us a little bit about your girlfriend.
Just another salt of the earth, a simple girl. I met her about three years ago when Anna was two, and just fell in love with the daughter.
You call her a simple girlfriend. She's not gonna be a girlfriend for long.
Yeah, I mean, honestly,
your relationship holds together because you treat Anna like a princess. Okay, do we have a name for the girlfriend?
Not yet.
Okay. Salt of the earth.
I was thinking something simple.
Sarah? Do we have a Sarah yet?
Okay.
Because that might have been a previous thing, right?
Yeah, that was the name of, I think, the person I had last time for the beta or whatever.
Okay, yeah, we've been playing a couple games lately and very basic names instead of Star Wars names. So, perfect. So we've got Sarah and Anna, and your relationship really holds together because Anna like a saint, and Sarah probably has a history of bad boyfriends in her wake as well.
Right, she's just happy with me because I don't hit her, you know?
Oh, jeez! Yeah, that's
love!
Yep.
Don't hit her!
So should I clap that out?
No! Okay. That's
okay.
That is an honest answer, just unexpected. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but I think it's
rough when you're poor, you know?
And the worst part is, too, is there are relationships with people like that. Yeah. And that's what a lot of this game explores, is the darkness in these shadows. So, moving right along, next question.
Okay, my next question is, what is your daily release? It's boxing, so I go and get in the ring.
Okay. Now, I know a lot more about MMA than I do boxing. If you know that much about boxing, like, is there different categories of boxing?
Yeah, so there's weight classes, but I don't care.
Okay.
I'll get
you.
There.
You mostly just want to get. Do you do it just for like the punching,
the release,
de-stress,
the release,
or
do you
want to break
the
people?
Release of stress? Depending on the day. Of
okay.
Course,
yeah.
So.
Do you ever see this as being like a career, or is this just
no,
something you do for fun?
No, this is just something that I do to try to, you know, get away from the world for a minute.
Yeah. Perfect.
So what do I desperately need? I desperately need for Anna to be the man that Anna thinks I am.
Okay. So Anna is five.
Yep.
She looks up to you. You're her, you know.
Does she call you daddy?
She doesn't. She doesn't.
Yeah. Mostly probably because Sarah doesn't want her to.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because you guys have been together for 3 years now.
Yep.
And Sarah still doesn't know if there's a future, maybe.
Yes, correct.
Okay. Now, there's a big aspect of your character that your intro questions don't cover.
Right.
Let's talk about your patron demon, right?
Right.
There is a demon who kind of pulls your strings. He gives you your power, and you owe him considerably for this. Right. We have a name for him, right?
We do. Nefaris.
Okay.
Is
Nefaris.
His name. And so the reason that he has, or he's my patron, is because when Anna was very small, she was three, and
pretty early in your relationship.
Yep, she got really, really sick.
Okay.
And so, basically, I sold my soul to save her, to get her better.
Deal. And I guess once we go into the character, we'll deal a little bit more with
Jake and
Nefaris's
what I do for him.
Yeah. Interactions.
Agreements.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so that is it for the intro questions. Any questions for Junior? Nope. Okay, perfect. Next, we're going to move on to gear. Now, like most role-playing games, you start out with choices for gear. Sometimes it gives you coins or money or whatever, but for this one, it just kind of gives you a checklist. Sometimes you can pick between options. For instance, the hunter archetype has a lot of weapons at their disposal that they pick between. Some other people have resources available to them. So go ahead and go through your list of gear and make any choices that you might need to. So while they're doing that, I'm going to touch one more time about the kind of basics of this game, the thoughts and processes about this game. This game doesn't have a spot on your character sheet for money. This game doesn't have a spot on your character sheet for some of those details, right? Some of the details about this game is not about rolling to hail a cab. It's not about doing, you know, checking to see if you make it to work on time or getting on the elevator and getting off on the right floor. It's not about those things. Those things are narrated as part of the fiction. This thing doesn't care about money. Obviously, these guys aren't going to be millionaires. They're going to be in various states of poor, well-off, rich sometimes, very much rich, very much probably poor somewhere around here, doing okay, poor, right? We have a spectrum. I'm not going to make Daniel keep track of his money. I'm also going to have to make sure that the fiction demands that if he spends all of his money, then he becomes reckless with his money and maybe he doesn't have so much money, right? But meanwhile, you know, we keep track of these things through the fiction, through ideas. I'm not going to babysit them and their money or their magic items or anything like that. That's not what we're interested in when playing this game. We're interested in the city. We're interested in the ambitions and the power and what you're willing to sacrifice to become what you want to become, what darkness is inside of you, what you're willing to give up of yourself to become something powerful. So is everybody good with gear? Okay, we're going to briefly just run through the list. We'll start with Junior because it looks like
still working. Stuff.
Okay. All right. So for my gear, I get to choose either a house or an apartment. I'm just going to get an apartment.
Perfect.
Something simple.
Yep.
I also get a car. But hey, I'm sure it's a car that doesn't run or has like a flat tire.
It's a car that gets you to the docks and back.
Public transit kind of guy.
And then I have a smartphone, but it's probably like a generic Chinese.
Like a Nokia brick.
You got something on the docks.
And I also carry a weapon. I carry a 9mm Beretta, but I never use it just because I carry it just to have for show. I'm more of a hands-on man-to-man. But I just have it because.
Talk big, aim small.
You keep it loaded then?
No.
Just in case.
I don't think I do.
You have ammo available?
I do have it available to me, but maybe I have...
like a clip in your car, your clip at home. Yeah, you have ammo available to you. The other thing I like about that too is that, you know, you talk big, but violence isn't always the answer.
Right.
You'd rather punch a bag than someone's face, but if they're asking for it, you can give them one, right? But taking a life is serious business.
Right.
And unfortunately, you know, we still haven't defined that part, but your patron demon might require you to take a life from time to time. So why would you want to if you don't have to, right? Perfect. Okay. Daniel.
I don't really have problems taking lives.
Sure
the job.
No soul kind of comes with that.
So for my gear, I have a secluded apartment.
Okay.
Which is on the 13th floor of a condo complex overlooking the bay.
Okay. Isn't the joke there that a lot of tall buildings don't have 13 floors? Mm-hmm. Perfect. Okay.
More supernatural.
Whoa!
I also have a comfortable car and a smartphone.
So are we talking like four-door sedan?
Probably.
Okay, like a nicer...
Which is funny because I could buy pretty much anything I want. I could have a nice flashy sports car, but...
Is it a two-door?
You know, you can fit more people in a four-door.
For your, like, picnics?
You could call them
feasting?
That.
Yeah.
But the doors open like Lamborghini doors.
Okay. Suicide doors. Oh, no, those are the best. So is it a two-door or four-door?
It's a two-door.
Okay, yeah. Because it's got to be about status.
It's got like the two-thirds back seat, too.
Because if you need space for it, you just get a minivan, you know?
Just get a U-Haul.
Yeah.
Just throw them in the back.
Yep. All right. So we've got a comfortable car. It's a nicer car. It's a two-door.
I also get a stylish weapon, and I have the choice between a sword, dual 9mm Glocks, and a Walther PPK.
Okay.
I am taking the dual 9mm Glocks.
Deal.
But if I need to use them, we're in the wrong situation.
Can you not hit a broadside of a barn?
No, I can. I was an infantryman.
Oh, yeah.
I have some experience, but I try and avoid those sorts of conflicts.
Deal. Yeah. The best part about being a vampire is living for a really long time.
Making sure that you can keep living. Yeah.
And there's a fair amount of hunters that roam the city looking for ambitious, murderous vampires.
So these are very stylish defensive weapons.
Or just status, an extension of your vampire penis.
Yeah, they're like chrome and tooled.
He's compensating.
Yeah. Aren't we all? Aren't we all? Welcome to Nerds and Stuff. Welcome to Nerds and Stuff. All right, is that your gear?
That's my gear.
Perfect. Sterling.
Cool. So I'll do the simple stuff first. I get a nice apartment, a crappy car, and a decent cell phone. So the apartment's just regular, I guess, fairly close to campus type apartment.
If I may, I kind of like the idea that you have a bedroom for your daughter that is just...
It's
a tomb.
Pretty much empty.
Yeah.
it's a bed.
It's furnished, but it's a tomb.
It's furnished with kids' stuff, and she's like a teenager.
Yeah. And then she almost hates you more for it, but, like, it hurts just a little bit to walk by it every single day. Yeah.
Crappy car. I'm thinking...
It's something like... Crappy purple Scion.
I was thinking, like, a... Chevy Corsica, or like an old school neon. Dodge Neon.
Somebody's got a neon.
Yeah. An ancient history professor has a neon. I think that's just standard.
Yeah, with like different colors.
Like the university just hands you the keys from the previous ancient history. Yeah.
And it says a decent cell phone, so I'm picturing like an iPhone, but it's always like two versions behind.
Oh, okay.
Like, no matter what, it's two versions behind.
You have to like be very selective about the apps you download because they're not supported anymore.
Yeah.
Have you guys got the app?
I don't. I don't roll dice, though.
I get one practical weapon, which I took a snub-nosed revolver.
Okay.
And then I get a focus and a sanctum. And so my focus is an amulet that I use to channel my powers.
Okay.
And I get to pick a benefit from it. And the benefit I got is gain one additional hold when I use channeling.
Perfect.
And if I channel without it, I actually take a -1 penalty to my channeling.
So we're not going
to
go into mechanics too much, but gaining an extra hold when you channel your magic is basically when you decide to become magical, you have access to more spells. Perfect. Okay. And then what was that -1 thing?
It's just when I channel without it.
Okay.
It's harder to channel.
So if someone jacks your bling, you're worthless.
Yep.
All right. And you have -1 hold or...
-1 to channeling, so it'll be a penalty when
so,
I gather.
So generally, it might use spirit to channel.
Yeah,
oh, no. Yeah,
it does.
Okay. I gotcha. Right.
And then, so the sanctum is a magical location.
I just pictured like your bathroom is just like blinged out. You know, like that's my sanctum, boys. Welcome. All right, go ahead.
So it's actually in his closet. There's like this. I just have this image of him like getting home from class. Like, taking his coat off, hanging it up in the closet, closing the door, and then opening it again, and there's, like, just a massive library inside there.
So he has to be in the closet when it closes, right?
No.
Oh.
Outside.
He
opens the door,
steps in, closes it behind him, and then opens it and steps back out.
That would be great, too.
Yeah.
And then, like, from in there, there's a whole bunch of other rooms and stuff, but from any room, he can get out again.
Okay.
Magic, man. But I get to choose four... beneficial features for it and two negative features.
Okay. For your sanctum, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So it has a library of old tomes, a scattering of ancient relics, magical wards, and an apothecary.
Okay.
And then for the bad conditions, it contains many volatile substances, and it always lacks a key piece or ingredient.
Fair enough.
It's probably because he's so disheveled, he can never find what he's
looking
for.
It's not lacking,
it's
just misplaced.
He just doesn't know where it's at.
Yeah, perfect. Right, so I will get that information from you in between this and the first session so we can work with making that fun. So, from your understanding, what does a sanctum do for your character?
I can use it to create magical things that I don't necessarily have ability to through spellcasting.
Okay.
If I need bits of knowledge or information, there's books and
stuff. So it's like a bat cave for you, really.
It is.
Yeah, perfect.
It really is.
Perfect, yeah. Right, complete with like a snooty Mr. Tumnus.
I don't know what's in there until I need to go in there and get it.
Perfect. Do you have like a magical butler or anything?
No, that was one of the options.
And you didn't
I didn't take it.
What?
You can get there with advances. Man.
Yeah, with advances I can get that.
Man, that
he has to file paperwork first.
Yeah.
It's a process.
Yeah, well you have to get your shit together first before someone will work with you.
He has to find the paperwork.
Yeah, he used to have a person and he quit.
I forgot which room I put him in.
Yeah, he has a bunch of important critical items with him. Yeah,
you let him in the last time you were experimenting and then left him in there and quit doing magic for like 15 years, came back, and he's just ingredients now.
Yeah.
It's like Gamers 2 where it's just a guy sitting next to a giant chest. Perfect. All right, moving on. That is all of our gear, and now we're going to move to archetype moves. So this game has some, at its basic mechanics, it has access to what's known as moves. Moves are a combination of combat skills and role-playing skills, non-combat skills. And basically, these are moments in the fiction that cause you to roll dice. I'm sure there's a much more eloquent way of describing moves that's written in the book, but basically, anytime your character wants to do something where the outcome is unknown, it generally relies on a move of sorts. Now moves, you guys can go ahead and start on your archetype moves. Now moves, there are several basic moves that are available to all of the players, irregardless of their archetype. And I'll kind of briefly touch on those. We'll go through each one of them as they come up in the campaign. But just to give you guys some examples for the viewers, some of the moves might be to unleash an attack. Everybody has access to that. To escape a situation that they'd rather not be in. This can be a scene or it can be an immediate moment. They can persuade an NPC to get what they want through promises, seduction, or tricks. They can try and figure someone out, what they want, what they need, who's pulling their strings, etc. So really gauging someone, looking at them, a sort of perception skill. There's mislead, distract, or trick. These are very much sort of the other social skills that lead you to dupe someone to get them to do what you want by tricking them. There's a couple more. Keep your cool. This is telling the MC what situation you'd like to avoid. This is a very flexible skill. It's a kind of catch-all. And then next is letting it out, unleashing the supernatural powers within you to accomplish something that your magic or your attacks might not normally do. And lastly, lending a hand or getting the way is very much a reactive move to complicate what others are trying to do around you to their benefit or detriment. So these are the basic moves that are available to everyone in the game. And now because they have their archetypes, they have specific archetype moves that is very specific to how a wizard uses magic, how a vampire creates his web and seduces those around him, and how the tainted goes about serving his master the best way possible. Now each person gets basic default moves that their archetype comes with, and then they get kind of an a la carte choose one or two or three to build a specialized class, so that way vampires have different feelings in their play styles. So, does everybody have their archetypes picked out? Yep, perfect. Okay, I'm going to start with Sterling. Let's hear about your basic move. We don't want to hear all the logistics.
Yeah,
we'll get into that when we get into it. Just a brief description of the idea of it, right?
So, I have channeling, which gives me the ability to cast spells. And then the spells that I picked tracking, which is being able to find people or objects.
Through magical means,
through magical means.
You're not picking up dirt and smelling it.
Yes.
You're seeing magical footprints.
Elementalism, which is magical weapons, your fireball, your
lightning bolt.
D&D move. and then teleport.
Magic missile.
Allows me to blink. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
And then the other move that I have is Sanctum Sanctorum, which is on how to use my sanctum and how I get stuff from it.
Oh, so is that something
you have to... It's a mechanic, yeah.
Is that something that comes with the wizard already?
Yes.
Okay, it's not something you have to pick to where, like,
no.
You either don't get a sanctum or you do. So, okay, so it's sanctum and
it's
casting magic, and you get to pick between your spells to customize your wizard, right?
Yes.
You don't get a couple archetype moves like these guys do.
No, I got three spells.
Okay, perfect.
To choose from.
Okay, all right, Daniel.
The kind of default one for the vamp is called Eternal Hunger.
Okay.
Essentially, this is my hunger for human blood.
Feeding, right?
Yeah. I need to feed to survive. And while I can eat human food just fine, I need other things. And, other than that, I have chosen Irresistible, which makes me incredibly good at persuasion.
When you said that, too, Junior gave me this weird fucking look for some reason.
Just, wow. It makes me really good when I'm persuaded
Daniel
with
is irresistible.
Promises or seduction.
Okay. So it's just that classic vampire allure. Yeah. That
like
pheromone.
Really good.
Yep, perfect. And like super good, like cream your jeans.
Okay. Like I can't actually fail.
Okay, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Comes with consequences, but... And the other move I chose is called Haven. And this effectively gives me, like, a vampire sanctum,
okay.
Which is a safe place, secure from outside dangers. It comes with emergency rations, a few ghouls, and an escape vector.
It's called Don't Stake Me, Bro, hang
Don't
up.
Don't Stake Me, Bro!
So, let's hear a little bit more about your haven.
So, in this building, where I have my apartment,
mm-hmm.
I also have my haven. Okay. I own this building, and there is a secret button in the elevator, which takes me down there, and it's actually a sub-basement below.
Okay.
Inside, I have a couple of ghouls. Ghouls are kind of interesting. They're undead that just kind of find vampires to serve.
Okay.
We're not really sure how they're made, but they just come out of the woodwork to serve. It's like part of our curse or something. We have to deal with these people.
Are they semi-sentient, or are they...
Yeah, they are. They are, I would say, like... 80% human.
Okay.
But they are technically undead.
But these aren't like people you carry conversation with, right?
These are like servants.
Okay. They're like silly putties, or like Putty Patrol from Power Rangers. They just make a lot of like, sound effects, and your reader reports are surrounded by idiots. Yeah.
And I've got one that's kind of like a friend. Thralls is a good word.
Yeah.
Like a friend butler.
Yeah. Perfect. And so, briefly touch on Haven and the benefits you get. You get, like, a place where you don't get staked.
I get a safe place that has emergency rations.
Okay.
Think of that as you will.
Yeah, juice boxes full of blood. Yeah.
You bite the box.
They have punch holes for your teeth.
Two of them.
You don't even put a straw
on. Not tin foil, though.
Oh, that would have hurt. Yeah, yeah.
It's
actually flesh. It's a thin membrane of flesh. Oh, jeez.
Oh,
yeah.
My goodness.
Yeah. That's your next company, your next Shark Tank. Yeah,
working on it. Sometimes the flesh gets a little old.
Yeah, well, the juice boxes only really last for so long.
Yeah, they've got a shelf life.
Yeah.
It comes with the ghouls as kind of servants, and an escape vector. So if somebody is breaking down my haven...
And so is that leading into the underground network of tunnels that Sterling
brought
up? It
is,
okay,
which perfect. Takes me into my garage, where I have my comfortable car.
Not in the tunnel network, though.
No, the tunnel network, I have a route.
Okay. Yeah.
I have other escape vectors.
It's like, you don't put
too,
your car in the tunnel network.
Just, I lift it down in.
Perfect.
Also, if someone willingly comes into my haven, they immediately enter my web.
Yeah, and they're immediately, like, repulsed by your ghouls, yeah.
Well, they're so enthralled with me,
mm-hmm.
they don't even notice the ghouls.
Yeah, until the ghouls are, like, going through
their
purse. Yeah. Perfect. Is that all of your Archetype moves?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Junior.
So my move is the Devil Inside, which is what it sounds like. I can take a demonic form.
Okay.
And it just gives
your patron demon gives you like a shapeshift
right.
that makes you really badass.
Right.
Okay.
And so it gives me a choice of different, I guess, plus bonuses when I take that form. And then the other thing I get to choose is Tough as Nails. So I just get a bonus to armor.
Okay. So, and that makes you more resilient against weapons.
Yes.
Okay. Right. So that's all of our archetype moves. Next is a type of move called drama moves. And each character archetype has three drama moves. There is an intimacy move, a corruption move, and an end move. Now the corruption move is the... Corruption in this game is a mechanic that... is a slippery slope. The basic premise of this game is that you you live long enough, or you, yeah, you die a hero or live long enough to see yourself become a villain. And the corruption move is exactly the easiest way to get to that second mentioned destiny, that destination. So with these corruption moves, when these things happen, your character marks corruption and becomes slightly darker within. They lose their humanity and become more of the feral, wild, unreliable, unraveling character that is the supernatural side of them. And so we'll go through the corruption moves. We'll go through all three of these moves at a time. I'm just going to brief them. The next one is intimacy move. When you share a moment of intimacy where you basically expose yourself to be vulnerable, you share a moment of intimacy, a secret, a quiet conversation of personal intrigue with another character or NPC, you expose yourself to the intimacy move. And the intimacy move usually has some sort of interactions that bring people closer together or puts them at a distance because of their supernatural resonation, I guess. And then lastly is your end move. These characters can be very fragile at times, especially with only having 5 boxes for hit points, so to speak. And when weapons deal an excessive amount of damage, characters can die fairly easily. And so when the character does eventually die, we trigger the end move, which is your parting gift to the world or to your enemy or to your friends.
A big middle finger.
Or a big middle finger. See you later, sayonara. So we'll start once again with the wizard. Let's hear about your corruption move, your intimacy move, and your end move.
Cool. My corruption move. When you strike a deal with someone dark and powerful, mark corruption.
Perfect. And we'll touch on these super briefly. These drama moves influence how you play your character. They give you a big clue about what is interesting to your archetype. Striking a deal with someone dark and powerful, I believe it said,
yeah,
tells me as an MC that I need to put him in a situation to strike deals with dark and powerful entities so I can get him to mark corruption so he can find that balance between hero and villain.
Mm-hmm. And then you want me to keep going on intimacy? When you share a moment of intimacy, physical or emotional, with another person, decide whether you care about them or not. If you don't, they go about their business as normal. If you do, they take -1 ongoing to escape until they get some intimacy somewhere else.
Okay, so you have some baggage that comes with your...
Like a stage 3 clinger.
It's very much the magic destroys those that are closest to you.
Perfect,
I think.
Yeah. So... being a wizard is tough, and mm-hmm. having those close to you is definitely tough as well. And your end move.
When you die, you may place a devastating curse on someone nearby.
Jeez.
Specify the effects of the curse and how they may end it.
Deal. So when you pass away, you put a ticking time bomb on someone else's back. Mm-hmm. Perfect. All right, let's hear about the vamp.
My corruption move. When you feed on an unwilling victim, mark corruption. My intimacy move, when you share a moment of intimacy, physical or emotional, with another person, tell them a secret about yourself or owe them a debt. Either way, they enter your web and owe you a debt.
And the web is a vampire mechanic.
It is.
And that's part of your archetype. We won't cover the web right now. That'll be a big keystone of Daniel's character and gameplay, so we'll cover that during the campaign. But when he is intimate with someone, they enter his web. Whether or not he shares secrets.
My end move, when you die or retire your character, name someone in the scene you want dead. Your agents and allies relentlessly pursue them.
Perfect. I love the fact that maybe like you three are just having some beers and you like drink yourself to death and you're like, Sterling! The ghouls come after him. Yeah. Perfect. All right. So when you die or retire, you put a death sentence on someone. Perfect. And the tainted.
So for corruption move, so when you persuade someone on your patron's behalf, I mark corruption.
Perfect. Your patron will put you in a lot of dangerous situations where you need to manipulate or take advantage of people.
Exactly.
And when you do that, you become more like your patron demon.
Okay. For my intimacy move, when you share a moment of intimacy, physical or emotional, with another person, they give you a debt that they hold on someone else.
Okay. And debts are a major driving force of this game. We'll go into more detail here in a little bit. That is actually the last step of character creation.
And finally, for my end move, when you die, cash in all the debts your patron owes you to come back. If you have none, your patron will ask someone else to pay the debt for you. If they refuse, time is up. It's been a good run.
Yep. So, two aspects of the vamp, and especially the tainted, is a lot of the game's mechanics make them very difficult to kill. And, you know, there's a lot of GMs out there who play to total party kill or wipe their party. We like to play games where we explore characters and explore issues and explore humanity. So two of these characters have picked stuff where...
Debt heavy,
and also, you know, vampires, obviously, unless they die very specific ways, they might just be vulnerable or left unconscious or repair over time. The Tainted quite literally has a mechanic that says... If you're, I believe it, is it you owe your patron,
so,
or your patron
no,
owes
No, the patron
you?
Owes me.
Yeah, so if the patron so owes you, it. If you work for your patron, he will keep you alive. And if you don't work very well for your patron will reach out to people and lord over them. And this could be
now,
fellow friends, this could be...
We give the patron a debt, or does he take one on us?
Yeah, so if he were to die, and he doesn't have any debts that his patron owes him... The patron might come to you, or it might come to NPCs close to him, and say, "You will be in my service. You will owe me to bring Jake Gordon back to life."
And then he enters my
no,
way.
That's good.
I'm good. Fine. I've got enough on my plate. I'm a busy wizard. You can just call me Bizzard. Perfect. All right, and that was your end move. So we are through the drama moves. Next. Is the introductions. Now, traditionally, when we're playing as not recording this for our YouTube channel, this is where you introduce your characters. Obviously, we've been going through that this whole way. Everyone should have a really good feel of who each other are at this point. Mm-hmm. So we don't need to do introductions. We have a good feel for who we are. We've asked our probing questions. We've talked about what our characters mean. The last part is we don't really know who we are to each other, or who we are to the world as far as our relationships. And relationships are largely defined in this game by debts. Daniel here could have all the money in the world, but unless he has debts that people owe him, he really doesn't have that much power. Junior here could be the poorest guy in the world, but if people owe him, that is power. Debts in this game are power. Owing someone a debt means they have power over you. Having someone owe you a debt means you have power over them. So let's talk about debts. Now, in the rule book, each archetype gives you a choice of one of three. They give you a choice of three debts to pick from. And in the rule book, it says you get to pick one of these. Now, my players are sadists, and they're a little bit crazy, but you probably know this from watching Legacy of Ash. And they have decided to activate all three of the debts, so that way we have a strong foundation for the start of our campaign. And there's a giant spider web being developed with our NPCs, with who owes what and how much. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and start with Sterling, and we'll have him define his debts.
Okay. So the first debt, someone is helping you keep your demons at bay. You owe them a debt. I think I would like that to be Toad.
Okay.
Toad is the fae that we came up with.
Yep.
That owns Toad's Tavern, place I frequent.
So, you owe Toad how many debts?
Just one.
Okay. So, Toad, one debt. Hi, Sterling. And he helps you keep your demons in bay. And how exactly does he do that?
I think a lot of it is he, I think he kind of also spent some time over there and knows what happened. He's one of the few people I have kept in contact with.
From
England.
Europe? Okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
So...
That would make sense for why he runs an English pub.
Yeah. And so I think he's one of the ones I can talk to. He calms me down when I start, like, freaking out about things. And
He understands, like,
he understands,
very few people in your life do. Okay.
Next one, someone is your go-to to when you get into trouble. you owe them two debts. And I think I'm going to pick Jake Gordon for this one.
Okay. Should write this down.
That's me.
That's you.
Yeah.
That's,
oh, no!
I'm just kidding.
That's you.
I'm just kidding. And sorry, what was that one more time?
He's my go-to when I get into trouble.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense. You owe him a debt.
I owe him two debts.
You owe him two debts. So I have two debts over Sterling, right? And generally, when we're talking about debts, usually when you call up a debt, you remind him for something. Now, this sounds more like a generic, like, I take care of you kind of guy, you know? Like, when you let things get out of control, I help bring you back. So this isn't maybe a specific example, but a series of shenanigans.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, perfect. If we want right now, we can define maybe how you guys met or how you guys know each other.
I imagine we probably just met hanging out at pubs. It sounds like we kind of like to visit similar types of places.
Absolutely.
So we probably hit it off. Eventually, I found out about his demon. He probably pulled me out of a hairy situation one time, and since then I've go to him when I kind of need, like, hey, I could use some muscle.
Yep.
I got into some trouble, let's...
More like, instead of like, hey, I need help with this, instead of like, hey, I've got an idea for a situation, it's like, please, I need your help.
Yeah, exactly.
Can you transform and do that thing where you punch through walls? Perfect. And that was two debts.
Yeah. And then the last one, you were helping someone keep a dangerous secret. They owe me a debt. And I've been trying to think of this one, and I have been having a little bit of trouble thinking
okay.
of who might...
Let's hold on to that and see if they create... One of the aspects that I really like about this game is it talks about PC-NPC-PC triangles
mm-hmm.
to where the two of you
share
an NPC.
That's
or
kind
the
of what
two
I was
you,
thinking.
Yeah, so we can come back to that, but just don't let us forget that.
Okay.
All right, Daniel.
Okay, so my first one. Someone makes sure you get fed regularly. You owe them two debts.
Okay.
I'm going to have this be Mistress Ivy. She kind of runs the Crushed Velvet sex club.
Okay. And why does she perform the service for you?
I was one of the original financial backers to the club.
Okay.
And so because I'm also a frequenter and kind of a regular face, and ensure that the club's secrecy is upheld and that they have regular funding, this is kind of why she helps me out.
Okay. Now, what was her name again?
Mistress Ivy.
All right. Okay, next debt.
For my next debt, someone relies on you for their fix. They owe you a debt. I was thinking that this would be Mr. Gordon here.
Okay.
He is a somewhat violent person, and so I actually sponsor him in blood sports privately, so that he can fight in competitions, and I also pay for his boxing gym membership.
And is this, he fights as a tainted, or as his demonic form?
Sometimes.
Okay.
Sometimes they're supernatural fighting events, other times they're just mortal ones.
Where he really gets to unleash his volatileness. So that was, he owes you one debt for that?
That is correct.
Okay. And you sponsor him for that because he can't pay entry fees, or he doesn't have the connections?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. And last one? So you owe Daniel one.
The last one.
Bloodsport.
Someone bears responsibility for you becoming a vampire. They owe you a debt. This is Reynald, the Nazi vampire. And when I find him, I plan to cash in on that debt.
And so he owes you or you owe him?
He owes me.
Okay.
For ruining my life.
Look, I'm sorry.
For ruining me for multiple 20, lifetimes.
He has 20 bucks, slugger.
Rips off head. Or something. Removes all limbs.
Uh, Alrighty. Junior.
Alright, so my debts is you're protecting someone from a dark power, they owe you two debts. So initially I was thinking that it may be Anna, because that's what I sold, but I don't know if having a 5-year-old in my debt would make
and
sense.
And the problem with debts, too, is like they have such a strong mechanical
right.
influence.
So
I really don't see you being like, Anna, you owe me.
Unless the other person I was thinking would be my aunt, but I don't know why I would have...
A dark power sensor.
Yeah.
That's the fiction, man. We play to find out.
Unless that's like the leverage that...
No, that's perfect. Your aunt is threatened for some reason, and we play to find out what that reason is, right?
I mean, his aunt could potentially be the person I'm helping keep a dangerous secret, but...
I actually love that
idea. At the same time, then it kind of excludes Daniel, and it's just like super...
I'll give plenty of debts, don't you
will.
You're in my web, by the way.
Yeah.
good Welcome to the fun.
I don't mind that at all. Because you have with him, so it seems like he's kind of what's
tying everything
the introduction between you two.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think that's great, especially where you guys have that synergy from Legacy of Ash, and we're bringing Junior in for this new campaign.
What was your aunt's name?
My aunt's name was Susan.
Susan.
Or is Susan.
Okay, so Susan owes you, right?
Debts, yeah, she owes me a debt.
She owes you two debts, Junior,
yeah.
Right? For
protecting her from a dark power.
And, you know, she knows about your supernatural side.
Right.
We talked about this, protecting.
Maybe
so
that's what I'm hiding.
It could even be a rival demon.
It could.
Absolutely.
That is
like,
trying to cause you pain. Because
yeah.
you work for
this, the city is a dangerous place, and she lived here before you
right.
did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe she's a waitress because she's hiding out. So let me go back to Sterling real quick. This is probably riveting video. Sterling, she owes you a debt.
Owes me a debt because I'm helping her keep a secret.
Maybe that's how you found out it was demonic. She went to you to
yeah. It sounds
learn
like you guys
it.
Might have met through pubs, but definitely. Through her, you know.
Mm-hmm.
She might have went to, because you're a history, she might have thought, you know, learned about demonic stuff
okay.
or something.
Junior, next.
Someone is trying to save you and keep suffering for it. You owe them two debts.
Okay.
So, I don't think it'd be one of these guys.
So, someone keeps suffering.
Yeah, someone is trying to save you and keep suffering for it.
So... That kind of sounds like your girlfriend to me, right?
Right.
It's
all because he doesn't get her.
Oh my gosh, like I didn't want to go there, but she keeps suffering, and this is emotional, you know, this is,
emotional
you're
support.
You're not there a lot, and when
right.
you are there, you're only there for her daughter, and so
and
she...
randomly come home, like, covered in bruises and stuff.
Yeah, and so, like, she is emotionally suffering
right.
because... As much as she might want you to be around, you're very flaky. You know, you're very not emotionally there. You're dark and brooding, you know.
Yep.
So,
Sarah.
So you owe Sarah two debts.
Two debts. And the last one is you have a demon who holds a contract for your soul. You owe them three debts. So that's Nephrus.
Yep.
So how did I find out that you were wanting to be a fighter?
Maybe you were going to the local gyms or something.
I actually want to bring it back to the docks. I think the docks should be a major
mm-hmm.
campaign location for us. I can't imagine that you don't have business going through these oceanic transport ships. Yeah, like...
Food trafficking.
You come down to the docks and you're looking for trustworthy people... who you can take advantage of, but also give back. You're like a Robin Hood. You're like a Robin Hood who kills people by
it's
drinking their blood.
By
drinking their blood. Yeah. is that cool? Like you
yeah, sure.
you vetted him, right? And then you found out what he wanted, and you gave him the opportunity to do that. Right?
I invited him for a drink and then, like, plied
his
vices. And
then you ate somebody and he's like, man, that's not my bag.
Plied his vices, figured out what he really was.
Yeah.
And
he's a fighter through and through.
And he may not win much, but if nothing else, it keeps him in my pocket.
Yeah. Well, not only that, like...
You never know when you're going to need muscle.
Yeah. Especially demonic muscle. Yeah. Perfect.
Muscle that's hard to kill.
Yeah, so, and then you... What was that last one? You owe...
Nefarious.
Nefarious, yeah. Yep.
3 debts.
Ooh. Almost like you signed your life away.
Yep. Yep. It's almost like that. My life was longer with 3 debts.
You were in a bad place. It was all he could bargain for.
Yeah.
So, the debt moves are the final aspect of character creation. We have solidified our relationships between each other. Maybe not solidified, we have begun the infrastructure. These guys will be playing out the narrative, interacting with each other, interacting as their characters, sometimes being spontaneous NPCs with me, playing to find out what happens in our campaign, in our new Urban Shadows game. So, thank you very much. We'll put a, like I said, earlier there was a card for the actual first video. It'll come up after this outro, so have a wonderful time, and we really hope that you enjoy our brand new Urban Shadows campaign. We go on rants sometimes, mostly by we, I mean me. But, you know, if our audience didn't want it, they wouldn't come around every fucking video.
1,800 people want to see this shit.
I mean, like 1,100 want to see miniature paintings.
Probably.
The 700 that are subscribed for role-playing games, here we are!
This is for you!